this is Rob Bauw, and today in Turbo Talks, we're talking to Eike Visbeek of SEG Racing Academy. Alright everyone, welcome back to a new episode of the Turbo Talks. Thanks for tuning in again, and as in every show, we've got a guest with some great insights from within the professional world of cycling. And today's guest has had a lot of success in recent years as a sports director. He even has a Grand Tour victory on his resume. And since early 2020, he holds the role of Academy Director at SEG Racing Academy. So I'm very curious to hear from him about the Academy, his work there, and the special challenge that is currently running in a joint effort with Tex. And that might even lead to a new discovery of new talent. So I think it's time to switch over to our guest from today. It's Eike Visbeek. Welcome, Eike. Thanks for joining us. How are you going?
Thank you. Yeah, I'm doing well. It's good weather, and we're hopefully ramping up to a racing season in August.
It's slowly getting closer. We're recording this on the 24th of June. You've been, I would almost say, like hiding in Sweden during this lockdown period. How has that been for you? And how have you been able to work as your role as Academy Director from there?
To be honest, we have been busy. Also the recent months. I've been directly already at the end of March, we switched to e-racing. And combine that with every week a webinar where we talk about specific subjects within cycling, whether it's time trialing or bunch printing. We even had some of the previous riders from the Academy that turned pro, like Fabio Jakobsen and Rory Sutherland, that joined us on webinars. So actually, as the Academy, we have been trying to keep on educating our riders. And we have used our time in a very efficient, effective way, I think.
Yeah, because I've mentioned the SEG Racing Academy, the Sports Entertainment Group Racing Academy. Can you explain to us a little bit like what the Academy does?
Yeah, SEG Racing Academy has is one of the leading development teams and leading in developing future pro riders. And some of the riders that come from the Academy are Kees Bol, Fabio Jakobsen, Eduardo Affini, Alberto Dainese, and there is really an goal to develop in a perfect surrounding talent cyclist, and it's an international team, so we have riders from all over the world. And because SAG also has an agency background, which is separate from the team, but with this background, we are able to provide talented riders and a future within pro cycling.
And you joined the team, previously you were a sports director at Team Sunweb, and now you're the role as Academy Director. What do you bring to the table for SEG?
Well, I think first of all that 7 years in the World Tour has made me experienced and also see the important things to succeed for young pro riders, but also of course the traps, the things that stop riders from developing once they turn pro. So I think what I bring is experience, and in that sense also be able to really give a good coaching and also a good development part in turning pro. And that is what I'm focused on with the riders.
So how did you turn into coaching yourself? Because you used to ride, I think you had a few years as a pro, then sort of like quickly became a coach and sports director. What made you make that transition?
It was a bit forced because I was 21 when I got a knee injury. And I got back on the level, but it always held me back a little bit, my knees. And I was still studying general management at that time. So I actually, on a young age, I already quit at 24 and directly turned team manager for a local cycling club, which is happened to be also the club of Nicky Terpstra, Ramon Sinkeldam, Kees Bol. So I started coaching riders there. And ever since, that was 2001, I've been a sports director and coach. And I've now almost 20 years experience.
So when you say you had to cut your own career short, is that then something that immediately makes you able to like translate to the current situation and working with those current young riders and give them some perspective on what their career could be and how quickly it could end? Or
yeah, well, I mean, I think first of all, it was definitely an advantage that I was a young coach. So the generation gap was not that big for a while. That is definitely something you can bring to the table because, when you're a young rider, you think everything is about the results and the races. But you also need to have a little bit of a helicopter view to really see what you're doing. Are you really focusing on the things as a rider, on the right things to improve? And I think that experience and that, helping the guys with stepping out a little bit out of the tunnel and see what they're focusing on. And work with them on that. I think that is really has been helpful and effective.
And is it for you that you? How do you compare the energy that you get out of coaching compared to the energy that you get out of riding yourself?
Cool. I would say almost that you're equally tired at the end of the day, but I think it's more diverse when you coach. First of all, you coach different riders, different personalities. And you were also responsible for the organizational part around it, which is also can give quite some satisfaction when you see that the team, your plans, the logistics, everything works in a good way, because it definitely helps, if you make sure that the recovery meals are there in time, if you have a smart travel plan, you also create advantages for your riders within races. So it's more diverse. As a cyclist, you're really focused on your own performance and your own well-being, and as a sports director, you take care of the well-being of 7-8 riders, plus the staff, plus the team, going from one place to another.
And you already mentioned like the satisfaction that you could get out of the job. Is there a particular moment in your career, besides maybe the obvious one, that you gained like most satisfaction out of? And with the most obvious one, I mean the Giro victory with Tom.
Yeah. No, I think the Giro victory was most of all the really hard work and really good cooperation with Tom and with the team, where we actually were an outsider and really make the most of the situation. So that was really, and also for me, a step up to the big podium. But I also have to say, and I mentioned it before, I coached a lot with Wilco Kelderman, and getting him back after a really horrific crash and injury, and get him to do a top 10 in the Vuelta was maybe even a bigger challenge to achieve. So I also get a lot of satisfaction out of helping riders going from a bad situation to a good situation, or really developing into a better athlete or as a person as well. I mean, you not only talk about with riders about their performance, they also have to deal with, the social life, study, career, family issues. So,
And have there been people now already at SEG or maybe a young rider that came up to you and asked you what it was like in the Pro Tour already at that level, or in the Grand Tour, etc., just to sort of being a sponge and gain that information from you? Or is that something that just comes over time for them?
Yeah, no, they have. And it's actually, we do the webinars, and of course I always a lot flick in with experience that I have from my teams. But with the webinars, it's really fascinating to see, because I remember from my Sunweb time when we were sometimes at the training camps doing presentations that, you had a hard time getting all the riders down to the room because they were not always super motivated to do it. But with the webinars at SAG, there is not a single rider that wants to miss it. They're really sitting there with their pens and papers. They make notes, which is, and that's also the academy. And that's also why we at SAG, I think the last year, have been very successful. We want riders that really want to develop. We not only want riders that want to race the nice races. We want riders that really make the choice to become a better rider and see it also as an academy. And that that's really cool to see. And I have to say, the high level questions, I mean, they really think things through, and that's really cool to see.
So how do you scout the riders for that? Because it goes way further than just looking at their wattage or their or the potential physical talent.
Yeah, for sure. Because it's really a combination. And that is, and especially now, there's a lot of focus on test results. And of course, we also look at that. But those test results, those watts per kilo, you need to be able to translate that into racing. So it's one indicator what the rider does at the races. It's another indicator what a rider can push for watts. And then you'll have to, and I think that's a very big factor. And I think that was also one of the, how do you say that, one of the things we were focused on with Sunweb for a while. That was the cooperation between an athlete or a rider and the team and coaches. What we want to see from young talent is that they also are willing to try new things, that they're not sitting in their own tunnel, what works for them, and not are able to want to make use of the experience that we have. And because in the end, that is what's going to make the difference. Because if you're in the under 23 category and you're winning races, you know, you start all over again the moment that you move to the pros. I mean, of course, there are the Remco Evenepoels, but those are, you can count them on one hand. All the other guys that turn pro, you know, they start from scratch again. So it is really important that you are, as a talent, are focused on getting better, on your development. And that is really what we also talk with the riders about, and see how high the cooperation level is.
And that might be the key ingredient for why you already mentioned some names. You had some really successful alumni over the past couple of years, like Denise Groves, I think this year even Schelling, and all those guys.
Yeah. I mean,
and I think there's even one rider who's in his last couple of days now with the team, right? Before he makes the jump.
Yeah.
Tymon Arensman.
Yeah. Also, and that's also a very interesting rider. Also, very high talent. Almost on the same level as Wilco Kelderman, Tom Dumoulin. But also a rider that in his first year already made a really big result with a second place in the Tour de l'Avenir, but could turn pro in, I think, 12 teams. But decided to stay longer with the academy to develop as a rider, because he could ride up a mountain really fast, but there were a lot of other things that he still thought he had to develop. And I think it's a good example of taking your time to get really ready to turn pro. And that is what we have been focused on with SAG. We obviously could have had maybe five riders turn pro more, but we really take our time to make the step right. It's there's no science about it, but you need to be ready, because it's at the moment a really high level at the World Tour. It's not easy to make the step.
Yeah. And one of the other things that you guys have been focused on, like you mentioned already, you were one of the first who said, okay, we're going to focus on e-racing since I think it was March. What was the thought process behind it, and how did that pan out for you guys?
Yeah. First of all, I think we were already very much aware directly at the end of February, March, that, you know, this could take a long time, that it was not a short stop that we were going to have. So we wanted the racing intensity for the riders. We also wanted to keep the style of racing, the preparing yourself for a race, to keep that a couple of months within the team. And so to also keep the dynamics of a racing season. And that was actually, and that is also with the thought in mind that we saw already the last winters that e-racing is taking big steps. And we already have from a couple of sponsors and partners the question, you know, we want to do a ride, a digital ride with some of the people that work and some of our clients. Can you guys join with a couple of guys on several platforms? And yeah, we already understood that those possibilities were there. And yeah, it was a big boom this spring, because everybody was in lockdown. But it is a part that belongs to if you become a pro rider, it belongs to your job. You need to be able to do digital racing and understand it. And it's like, yeah, a good opportunity. So that's why we also pushed for it. And I think also it made for the riders that the months were not that long. They had every week a race. They did the trainings. And I think that also made it, that they stayed motivated.
And is it easier maybe because they're a younger generation is it for them then maybe easier just to switch to something like more with a gamification element in it on a computer than maybe for older riders who've already been around for like ages in the peloton?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, the first guy that made me aware of this was Laurens ten Dam. He qualifies as an older rider. So I think, yes, I think the younger generation has a little bit easier with the digital world and doing these things than the older riders, with all respect. But I still think that it's gaining a lot of momentum at the moment, and it is really something that belongs to your pro cycling career at the moment when you're in the World Tour. I think it will be hard to say as a pro cyclist to your team, you know, for those events that are organized in the winter or during the season, you cannot say anymore to your team, I don't do them. I mean, I don't like it. I mean, it's something that belongs, like an activation or a sponsor event, a clinic or a meet and greet. This also is part of your pro cycling career.
So how do you reckon it's going to develop over when the racing resumes on the road again? How is this, is e-racing still going to be incorporated in their programs or?
Yes. Now, I mean, I think because it's a very special season, so I think for the month of August and September, if the races happen, because that we still don't know, if it's a full racing calendar, we obviously take a break 1 or 2 months from the e-racing, because we already have been doing it intensively now, I think the last 3-4 months. But I think the main takeaway point, and that is what you really see now, is that a lot of the riders understand that hey, doing your efforts to your intensity training, you can do that really efficient and really accurate on the trainers at home. And that's already what I've been seeing with some of the pros. I know a guy like Wilco Kelderman, he does also some of the efforts at home on his home trainer, because he wants to, he can do the efforts as planned and very accurately. And that, you know, you don't always get that on the road. So I think in that sense, the generation riders at the moment, they understand that, they're going to use it in a smart way. I see that already.
Yeah, it's definitely bang for your buck. It's like quality and time efficient in terms of like doing their workouts. So is it with you guys, do you especially like put it on the programs, okay, do these efforts on your indoor trainer?
Both yes and no.
Or is it more of a recommendation?
Yeah, no, I mean, definitely it's a recommendation. But there can also be like, especially with some of the GC riders and the time trial riders, we could be really saying, do this on the indoor trainer. So we know you get it 100% right. But definitely signal to the riders that certain trainings are better done on the indoor trainer. And then it's also, because you know, you also have to look at the circumstances for a certain rider. But yeah, and I see now, for example, with some of the riders, I have Stan van Tricht, who is studying, he's in the middle of his exams. Yeah, he's still, although he's training a lot of hours, he's making a really efficient use of his trainer. He trains, he can still learn, but he does intensity-wise exactly what he needs to do. So he's almost losing nothing and still does the full program at school. So if you use it in an efficient way, you can gain a lot.
And what will be then like the benefits? How do we see the benefits at the end on the road? Because like we've had Ashley Mormon-Passio on the podcast 2 episodes before you, and she already mentioned she's been training a lot of indoors during the lockdown in Girona. She went outside, setting a new Queen of the Mountain record at her favorite Strava segment. Is that something that we can expect, or is that maybe a bit over the top that we can suddenly expect people to go faster after they've been training indoors, or how do you see that?
I it's not a surprise to me, and we have it also black and white that it has been. If you look at specifically the efforts, I can't say directly racing because we haven't been racing, but it's the same trend that we see in our team. Not a single rider. We had a test week beginning of June, so we had riders like Marco Frigo, for example. He was maybe on the road for only 2 weeks training. Before that, only indoor. They all smashed their power records. So they're like the 30 seconds, the 1 minute, the 5 minute, 3 minute, 10 minutes, 20 minutes. They smashed their records, really. So, yeah, it has definitely a good effect. And like I said, then you also still need to make the second step and turn that into good road racing. But yeah, first of all, you need to be able to push the watts. And if you then make a smart plan to translate that into racing, yeah, then you're going to see the effects. But the personal records are all significantly higher. And also the improvement is also significantly bigger than we normally see in the last couple of years. So yeah, if you use it in a smart way, it pays off.
So expecting to see a trend, less riders on the road, more riders on their indoor trainer.
Yeah, no, I think in general we will see that definitely more riders will use those indoor trainers to do some training parts indoors, and I think that is a good trend to see.
Okay, talking about training indoors and throwing a bit of a challenge in. At the moment, already mentioned in the intro, there's a joint challenge with TEX, the SEG Performance Challenge. Three iconic climbs where riders can test themselves on through the TEX software to become a better climber. And maybe it's a 6 weeks program. And at the end of that program, maybe there's a spot at a training camp or SEG. Can you tell us a bit about the challenge?
Yeah. I mean, one of the most frustrating parts for cyclists at the moment is that they can't show themselves, and that is for ambitious, talented riders is a problem. And we said we want to give riders the opportunity to show themselves their climbing abilities, and do that in a period where they can also improve themselves. We have been putting out also training advices on the TUX training app, where they also can do some of the trainings that we do with our riders, where we can improve their climbing. And we really want to give them the opportunity to show themselves. And of course, we are not racing, and especially the North European riders, they won't be racing much this year in the mountains. But here they have three perfect opportunities to ride fast up the mountain. They have it in a 6 week period. They can plan their day, and they can get really good prepared. They have an in-view insight in how we train. And this is definitely a good opportunity to get our attention and open the door. And if we see a rider with good values doing it, and also with a good improvement in the 6 weeks, then we're going to invite that rider.
Okay, so the three climbs, and now my pronunciation is going to be tested, the Puy Major, a famous climb on Mallorca, the Galibier and Alpe d'Huez are the climbs that are featuring in this challenge. And every 2 weeks, they can climb like one of those. And like you already said, there are also some tips and tricks. And I think there's even like a dedicated training schedule for them available, right?
Yes, exactly. Because we've opened up the challenge. So, I mean, yes, there is definitely an opportunity for talented riders to show themselves. But it's also a very good way to prepare yourself. If you know that you now go on holiday in August or September and you're going to do some of these climbs, then this is a really good and effective way to test it and to get better for your holiday or when you ride yourself. So we also wanted to open it up with training schedules and give everybody a chance to improve. And we see a lot of good response in that. And I think it's a very easy way to quickly get on a good level.
And if you're listening now and you're thinking, okay, what are they talking about, that SEG Performance Challenge, how can I find out more? Go to tex.com/SEG Challenge and definitely enter the challenge and take to the test those climbs and see how far you get. And but how are you guys measuring the progress throughout those 6 weeks for the riders? And how do you scout the talents that might come out of that? Where do you pay attention to?
I mean, we also have our SAG riders doing the challenges. So we have also with that a good benchmark. Then again, we also look at their progress within the three challenges. And if then if all those indicators are positive, then we also invite those talents, and then we can do the next step in discovering these riders by seeing them live in action on the road bike, and also see how they think and what we already touched earlier, how the cooperation level is and if they are a promising athlete in the whole perspective.
And I can imagine if you're looking at the scout, you want sort of like trustworthy numbers coming out of those challenges. How do you guys like sort of make sure that those will come out of it? You can judge it.
Yeah, I mean, there isn't much hiding at the moment. I mean, of course you can try to get around the system, but you know, we have a performance team with four coaches. They are very good in making calculations. So the smartest way is to just, you know, put the information in as it is. It's difficult to beat the system in that perspective. So at the moment, what we see and what we calculate, we see that everybody is doing it in a fair way. But we make the calculations, so we also check the information.
Was there a certain reason to select these three climbs?
Yes.
Are they like different in length, gradient, etc.?
I mean, first of all, we also wanted iconic climbs. I mean, I think there's thousands of people going to Alpe d'Huez every year because it's an iconic climb. It's a challenging climb. So that was obviously the final that we wanted. It's also a bit of the benchmark that you hear about from a lot of people. And then we also wanted to start with a climb that is more graduate, more not too steep, but a good climb to start. I mean, the Puig Mayor is a climb that, although you're maybe not trained that good, you can find a good rhythm and you will get a real good sense of the climbing, how it is. And the Galibier is also an iconic climb. Is a little bit less, it has some steep points, but it's not as challenging as the Alpe d'Huez. Alpe d'Huez has some really steep parts, especially the first 3 kilometers are gruesome. But the Galibier is still a good mix of the Puig Mayor and Alpe d'Huez. So I think it's, in terms of climbing and learning and understanding climbing, it's a nice, step up. Puig Mayor is easy to climb, easy to find a good rhythm. The Galibier, it already starts a bit more difficult. You really face the gradients, steep gradients, but still doable. But and the Alpe d'Huez is really going from really steep beginning to flattening out in the middle part and then ramping up towards the top again. So there's a bit of everything, the three climbs.
So people still have a bit of time before they have to conquer Alpe d'Huez. Puig Mayor is open to climb in the challenge till July 1st, and then the Galibier is from July 2nd till July 11th, and then we head to Alpe d'Huez from July 12th till July 29th. So if you look at like the outcome, how many potential riders would you be able to invite to a training camp?
Oh, I would say everything between 1 and 10. I mean, like I said, SAG, we really want to get to know the talents. And we will definitely, when we see an interesting rider, we will not hesitate to invite them. But it's difficult to say now. I mean, there's a lot of talents coming in and we have to see how they perform and how they develop.
Is there a part in the process after finishing this challenge and before the training camp starts that they need to prove themselves in some sort of way? Or is it just straight from this challenge determines whether there is an invite or not?
Yeah, no, we contact the rider. So it could also already be after the first or the second challenge that we see something we like and that we contact. We are live. We are following the challenges and every day we look, we calculate and we see. So yeah, it could be after 1, 2 or maybe after 3 challenges that we contact a rider.
So are you getting like a daily report now?
Yeah. No, we're following it every day. And actually it's not only us that's following it. The Dutch Cycling Federation is following it. And yeah, we also have requests from other teams. We are with SAG Academy. We have a squad with a men's squad, but also the women teams know that this challenge is on. There was already some girls and that have been doing it, and yeah, they also want to know the numbers. So I mean, it's not only for us; it's open, and every team can see the results and do their calculation. So it's almost like an open application for yourself if you do this challenge. So yeah, it can really open the door not only to us but to other teams as well.
All right, awesome. Maybe to wrap it up, a quick look ahead to the season that still lies ahead of us, because you guys started 2020 actually really well with the team, with quite a couple of victories already. What do you expect, or what do you hope for?
Well, I mean, we have with David Dekker, obviously we had already a great season start, and also with Corbin Strong becoming world champion points race on the track. But we have a couple of riders that I think are really going to impress in August and September. Dan Hole, who is the Dutch champion time trial, but also Jordi Meer was already putting in some good results and won a Belgian pro race in the spring. These are riders that I think will definitely do some good results, possibly win some races. And also with Dan Hole, we are aiming for a medal on the time trial championships, both European and Worlds. So that are the big goals.
And what's the, do you know anything about like the program for the guys already? Which races are they going to be invited to, or on the schedule with everything that's been changed?
Yeah, well, it's there's still also a lot of, question marks around it. But we will start in Heise Pijl in Belgium. And at the 1st of August, then we will go to the Czech Tour, 6th to 9th of August. And from there, a couple of our guys will do the Tour de l'Avenir with their national teams. Yeah. And then if everything allows us, we will be doing the Baby Giro and X races in Norway. From there on, there's still some question marks around the program. We could be doing Tour de l'Isar, but we have to see. There's still those races still have to be confirmed if they will happen.
Okay. Awesome. I think we're going to wrap it up. I want to thank you, Eike, for your time and to explaining for us how everything's working at the SEG Racing Academy. I think some really interesting stuff going on there, and it's taking more and more prominent and more important place in the cycling world these days. So good work. Keep it up over there.
Thank you.
All right, everyone. That's a wrap for today's episode. Make sure you go out there. SEG Performance Challenge, as discussed, go to text.com/SEG Challenge and definitely take on the challenge. And yeah, as Eike already said, if you're under 23, if you leave it all out there, and who knows, maybe they were going to contact you and you'll be invited for a training camp with SEG. So thanks for listening again. And guys, you know the drill. Tell a friend about the Turbo Talks podcast and make sure you never stop cycling. This was Rob Pauw with Eike Visbeek of SEG Racing Academy. Stay tuned for the next Turbo Talks.